Hi, my name is Huang Zhengyu, and I am here with my co-host, Ken Wilcox, and we'd like to welcome you to another episode of China 411. Today, we're very honored to have a special guest to talk about a topic that's on very many companies' minds, which is corporate competitiveness, and she actually has a book to present as well. So we're happy to welcome author and instructor and teacher, Amy Karam.
Hi, thank
Welcome
you.
Welcome, Amy.
So, by way of background, a few years ago, I was living in China. I came back to the U.S. to sit on a panel at a conference at Stanford. And I was about China. And then after the panel was over with, this woman who's sitting next to me now approached me and wanted to chat a little bit about some of the things that I'd said. Mm-hmm. And it turned out she was working on a book about the competitiveness of American or Western corporations in arenas where Chinese corporations are also competing. And we got into a discussion and I got really interested in what she was doing. So here she is today. And Amy, why don't you start off here by telling us just a little bit about your background and what brought you to China and how you got interested in this topic.
All right, thank you. Thank you so much. And I do want to thank you for your inspiration at that initial chat that we had and throughout the years thereafter. I must say that you were a force that kept me going because you were very supportive on the importance of the topic. So thank you. Mm. And thank you for writing the foreword, in fact, as well. A little bit about me. I have an international MBA. I've always been interested in international business and specifically with emerging markets. And I have always been in the high-tech field, or for most of my career, in fact. I am from Canada originally and was recruited by Cisco Systems from Nortel to come down here and work in the San Jose corporate office for some time. And I thought I'd try it out. I liked it and stayed for a while. During my tenure at Cisco, I was a consultant to Tier 1 service providers, where I helped them develop their marketing and business plans. So it was a thank you by Cisco to say, you've made us successful, let us help you be successful in the business world. And then during that time, I kept positioning to executive management that emerging markets was really important, that we needed to focus on them, and that's when they tapped me for this competitive sales support position. In the mid-2000s, and they said, all right, here we go. You will be the global escalation point for all deals that had to do with dealing with Chinese competitors, i.e. Huawei or ZTE specifically at the time. And so during that time, I realized that this was really important. It wasn't just a trend or a blip. And I wanted to share the information with other Western-based companies because there was a lot of learnings along the process, So I wrote the book and branched off from Cisco, started my consultancy on global expansion strategy and competitive strategy, and here I am today.
So what would you say is the main theme of the book, or the main two or three themes? What are the headlines?
We, as Western-based companies, need to change our game, do things a little bit differently. Product superiority is no longer a winning element in our competitive experiences, all right? And so we also need to take emerging markets more seriously as a market that's integral as part of our strategy. It's not just a novelty anymore. Emerging markets, we need to do business in emerging markets more concertedly in order to expand and grow. And while we're there, we need to know that we need a different toolbox. Emerging markets have different expectations. They do business differently. And emerging competitors, like those from China and elsewhere, know these nuances a lot better than we do sometimes. And we need to get smarter about how business is done by them and in emerging markets and adjust accordingly. The other key element, another key theme, is the innovation advantage. We really need to get smarter about maintaining that and evolving our innovation advantage. In fact, if anything, we need to become innovative about being innovative. And because, of course, emerging competitors are getting smart in that arena as well.
So, Amy, yes. If we go a little bit deeper, what exactly are these Chinese competitors doing right?
Oh, they're doing a lot of things right, especially in emerging markets. One thing is they have a longer-term view. They're committed. They're strategic. And they're in it for the longer run, whereas sometimes Western-based companies are more short-term thinkers. And that's understandable because we are beholden to Wall Street, right? Quarterly financial reviews. They want to know how well we're doing every quarter, whereas that may not have been a stress factor, say, for the Chinese for a while. So they go to a market, especially in emerging markets, they invest, they look at the bigger picture, and they're there to stay. And customers in emerging markets appreciate that. They appreciate the commitment. They're also very good at solution selling. They kind of look at the big picture. What does an emerging market customer need in order to succeed and to purchase whatever they're selling? Financing is another big part of that. And they got very creative about offering financing options. And they're also very strong on the political front. They use politics really well in order to influence business decisions. And
so if that's true, and it sounds like, you know, a lot of the research done by you and others has shown that, you know, Chinese competitors like ZTE and Huawei have done great in the emerging markets, what's preventing American companies from doing exactly the same or even more?
I think it's just a shift. It's a shift in behavior. It's a shift in commitment. And it's a shift in financials, right? Really knowing that it will pay off and perhaps taking a shorter term hit for a longer term gain. We get very stressed about not getting the ROI in real time. And that's a big prohibitor.
How about in terms of solution selling? What's stopping American companies from being better at solution selling in comparison with their Chinese counterparts?
Yeah, I think it's just been a different expectation in the developed markets. So it's often been a product superiority play. My box is better than your box, so my box is going to win. And it's, you know, especially in the high tech field, it's been very, you know, here's my data sheet, here's the comparison. And so it's been, you know, a premium branding equity play as well. So it's a shift, it's an investment, and it's higher risk. Right? It's a higher risk to say, I as a Western-based company, am going to help finance this emerging customer who may or may not be able to pay me, or at least not in a time frame that I appreciate or want, for example.
So are you saying that Chinese companies are more willing to customize product to the needs, specific needs of the emerging market? Is that the...
Yes, that too. Thank you for bringing that up. Oh. Yes, absolutely. And because as an emerging competitor, a lot of times emerging players will be much more amenable to customizing in order for them to acquire a customer base, to establish themselves. It's a very common market penetration strategy. And if they can afford it, if they have the labor pool to apply to that, you know, to the customization, and if it's strategic enough, yes, they're very good at that.
The issue is, I think it's, I want to add one more variable. You're talking about greed and pain. I want to add paranoia, because I think the biggest issue is we're not paranoid. And if you're not paranoid, it's only a matter of time before you're going to experience pain.
Yeah.
But I think that we have taught ourselves that American corporations are exceptional.
Yes.
And we just buy into that.
Yeah.
And the problem is we're not even noticing the progress, I think, that's being made by some of these Chinese companies.
Yeah.
And going back to your first point, though, about Wall Street versus Chinese government, most of the companies we're talking about probably to one degree or another fall into the SOE category, state-owned enterprise. And we know, or at least we're told, even by Chinese economists, that many, if not most, of those SOEs are not very profitable. They don't have much of an ROI or an ROE. And yet that's what enables them to get a foothold in a place like Myanmar with those motors that I was talking about. And it applies actually to Huawei and to the others that we've been referencing here too. I think that's one of the big issues. I think we live a myth, Western companies, not just U.S. companies, Western companies in general, that we own the market, and that prevents us from seeing the kind of progress.
So we talk about five different models, innovation models, in the book. Mm-hmm. And the idea is co-opetition, a little bit of what you were saying, maybe just to summarize it in one word, is learning from each other. And the Chinese are very good at process or supply chain innovation. They've got it down to a T, right? Now, fine, you know, the cost of labor is increasing, and then there's other neighboring countries that are picking up the manufacturing expertise, right? Bangladesh, Vietnam, et cetera. However, you know, if we've got Martha Stewart, you know, with her Made in the USA branding, has she gone, you know, to Ken's point, to China to learn about their supply chain innovation and how to make it efficient and to make manufacturing in America that much stronger and more robust, you know, per what they think that we should be doing? I mean, right? It's that cross-pollination that's really going to make that innovation advantage be protected. And, you know, one of the case studies is also with Xiaomi, the smartphone manufacturer. And I love it because it brings together so many elements that we both talk about in terms of recommendations for the West in the book. They recruited talent from Google. They recruited Hugo Barra, right, the VP of product management for the Android phone, to come over and to build that phone business. The interface looks like the iPhone, right? They've been criticized that it looks like an iPhone. It is an Android platform. And they have applied this technology to the Chinese market. They've used social media phenomenon to amass the subscribers and the popularity. They have virtually zero marketing dollars invested because it's all customer input based. They have real-time updates as opposed to waiting for that, you know, iPhone 6S that's going to come out in 8 months, everybody wait in line outside, right? So they've taken a lot of the Western innovation and technology and talent and applied it to the Chinese market to become a number three player globally in only 5 years. It was just a phenomenal skyrocket. And so, you know, just another example to your point about, are we learning as well?
So how do you change the mindset of these American CEOs? Because obviously, they probably don't think exactly this way. If they did, they, you know, be probably going mm-hmm. to China a lot more often, sending their senior executives yeah. to China a lot more often.
They should read the book and take the workshop. That's how we're going to change one CEO at a time. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think, for one, that I know Amy's answering the questions, I'm not, but I want to insert here. I think that, for one, no matter what we think of the Chinese system, no matter how many criticisms we may have, we've got to get over the idea that the Chinese can't do anything right, because they're certainly doing some things, mm-hmm. not just right, but better than we're doing them. I'm not saying a lot of things, I'm not saying all things, but I'm saying some things. And if they're learning from us and co-opting our stronger points, but we're generally speaking, not that interested in learning from them and co-opting their stronger points, it's only a matter of time before they become as good as we are, or maybe even better in terms of the global competition. And I think that's the real issue. My view is, no matter how much you don't like your competitor, you need to understand your competitor and see if your competitor is doing anything better than you are. And I've never met a competitor that wasn't doing at least something that I should learn from.
So you mentioned something very interesting, which is this idea of paranoia, right? Mm-hmm. In some ways, America had actually experienced this paranoia with Japan.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
And the Americans actually started learning from Japan what you exported to Japan right after World War II, yeah. through the Deming system and et cetera. And if I may say, you know, Ken, you're probably old enough to have had experience that.
Ouch!
What occurred there? How did America actually wake up at that moment and say, you know what, Japan is somebody we cannot ignore anymore? Even though we, you know, conquered the country, It was a huge destination of American goods right after the war, but all of a sudden we have to pay attention and we have to learn from it. How did that mental shift happen?
I don't really understand why it happened to the extent that it did with Japan, and doesn't appear, at least in my perception, to be happening with respect to China.
Exactly.
But I know in the 1980s, there were so many corporations that were trying to learn about just-in-time and all kinds of Japanese approaches to business, but I don't really hear people talking about taking a close look at Chinese approaches to business. But I personally have observed some things that some Chinese companies are doing that we're not doing that we could actually learn from. And I can't figure out why people aren't taking that part more seriously. Because we did in the case of Japan.
But may I also add, with the case of Japan in the high-tech industry, especially during the Clinton administration, we educated them on the semiconductor success, if you recall, right? So they came and learned, and we said, sure, we'll partner. Sure, we'll make you stronger, because that's what we do. We're, big hugs all around. And we became weaker in the semiconductor industry because we weren't paranoid enough, perhaps. I'm totally speculating. I was way too young to be participating in it. I just had to read about it. But, right, so that's another example, I think, of how Japan, right, it used a little bit of the innovation and the strength to fuel its own strength.
Yeah, I mean, for me, seeing that parallel in some ways, it's very uncanny, right? But are there more parallels to what China is experiencing given the experience of Japan? Do you feel like China is on the trajectory that it will, because we've talked about the current positions, the current mentalities, but what about the trajectories? Are they on the trajectory that if left to its own device will eventually surpass or exceed what the US is doing now? Where do you think the trajectory is taking them to?
Yeah, what do you think?
We're asking you the questions.
You're the guest.
Yeah, I think they're a formidable player. I don't think they should be underestimated. And while there are parallels to Japan, in my humble opinion and my humble observation, they're a lot bigger right now.
Because this is the fascinating part. I remember reading about Japan actually becoming number one and taking over the world, right? Not just in GDP, but in technology and manufacturing, et cetera. And even though China today has a larger GDP than Japan, even though I think China's influence is probably much greater than Japan had exerted, right, at its Japan's peak, because at Japan's peak, they weren't having the kind of, as you mentioned, in-depth, long-term relationships in emerging markets that China has now. It seems that nobody really is talking about, is China really on a trajectory to achieve that kind of prominence as well? It's as if people think that, yeah, well, that's kind of a fluke. I don't know. I'd love to hear your thoughts.
Well, you spent 8 years there. Tell us what your observations were based on day-to-day envisions. Do you think that they might come down?
Well, one thing I do know is the government, along with the private sector, are working very concertedly and spending a lot of money on moving up the knowledge base. Right now, a national initiative and prerogative is to acquire technology from the advanced countries. And this technology extends to all areas, from biotechnology to nanotechnology to semiconductors to software, etc. And so they understand that while China has moved up quite a bit in manufacturing, in supply chain management, that they still lack in knowledge-based, economies and industries.
Sure.
So they made a concerted effort. So that's all I could say, that they're moving quickly towards that goal.
I don't think they're going to go away anytime soon. I think that's my quick answer. They're smart. They're strong. They're big in numbers. They're wealthy. I think they've crossed a point where naturally, in any emerging economy, there's going to be blips and up and down, but I don't think it's going to collapse in my crystal ball of...
Interesting. So what's the weakness for Chinese companies if you were to generalize? Because again, to use the Japanese parallel, the Japanese economy kind of cratered. And not only the Japanese economy cratered, mm-hmm. Japanese companies kind of faltered, right? You mentioned semiconductor. At one point, mm-hmm. Japan was the dominant force in memory production. Mm-hmm. Now they've ceded most of that dominance to the South Koreans. So what are the weaknesses that Chinese companies...
But let me remind you, they're still paying... they're still charging top dollar for cameras, which at one point were, a commoditized technology. But they have developed the expertise in that area to the point where they said, no, this is a Japanese brand. We are going to charge this much. And the world appreciates that quality label. So I think it's going to be a sifting. It's going to be pockets, right? And ownership of pockets of either industries or, for lack of a word, another word is domination or strength. But I think that's naturally what happens with any rapid growth circumstance, whether it's China or anyone else. So I think they'll find their nest.
Yeah. Still, there must be some weaknesses in the Chinese approach that you see in the companies that you've analyzed. There have to be. Has to be.
I think it's maybe cultural adaptation to Western ways as well. Some of the weaknesses can be over persistence, maybe pushing a little bit too much, and to a point where they're not respecting the Western boundaries and way of doing business. And there's also that innovation hurdle that they have to overcome, right? I think to their credit, they're hungry and they're aggressive and ambitious. But at the same time, that model of emulation versus their own creation, I think that's going to be something that is going to be integral for their bridging to their own steadfast success.
So what stops, to the extent that Chinese companies are not as innovative, what's stopping them? What are the hurdles to get over? You said one already. You said that they've gotten in the habit of emulation. And just breaking the habit of emulation and moving toward innovation, it's just it's a mindset. It's breaking a habit, so to speak. But are there any other hurdles for Chinese companies to come? Are there any cultural hurdles that make it more difficult, perhaps, for Chinese companies to move from emulation to innovation or not?
I think there's maybe ethical boundaries as well, right? Learning to play by the Western rules, the WTO rules. Like, I know that there's been a lot of, in the past at least, right, escalations in terms of the boundaries that they're willing to cross versus what we might be willing to cross in order to get business done. That would be one area, I think, that needs a little bit of improvement. There's fiscal disclosures, right? If they really want to play by Western rules and by Western games, that has to be more transparent. There has to be more transparency to equal the playing field, to level it out. Those are just a couple.
Hmm. Amy, besides having worked at Cisco, you actually consult a lot with, leading corporations, mm-hmm. both in the Valley and mm-hmm. outside. Talk about the leadership styles you see here versus the leadership styles you've seen in China.
I'd say the one word that comes to mind is empowerment of the employees, mm-hmm. and really embracing that freedom or tapping into it. I think that's really a big source of innovation and creativity for companies here. And perhaps it's more hierarchical in the East, right? There's more that the level.
I would add one to it, by the way.
Sure, please do.
Just based on my own experience in China, and that is that there is one big cultural difference between U.S. and China, in my observation anyway, is that in China, if you're CEO of the company, you can do no wrong, meaning your employees are constantly telling you that you're brilliant. And they're always beginning their sentences with, under the guidance of our wonderful leader, blank, 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 mm. blank. And I think they're disinclined to bring up ideas that may contradict the ideas of the leader, because it would be mm-hmm. taking face away from the leader, mm-hmm. and it would be considered culturally a faux pas. Whereas here in the U.S., it's often the case in many companies, not in all companies, companies vary, but that leaders encourage disagreement and mm-hmm. are thrilled when their direct reports bring up ideas that are better than their own. Mm-hmm. And I will say in my experience as CEO of Silicon Valley Bank that many of the best things we did were in contradiction of the direction I wanted to go, as opposed to in confirmation of the direction I wanted to go. Because people here, I think, felt pretty comfortable, many people, not all, of contradicting me and weren't worried about my face. And I think that's a huge advantage for American companies.
Well, Ken, let's flip that question, right? What are Chinese corporate leaders doing right? Mm. Because obviously they're succeeding in the marketplace, so they must
definitely
be doing something right.
They
but
must
what
be.
Are they doing that American leaders aren't doing?
So, Amy.
They are supporting financially, and they're supporting politically, right? So what I really like about some of their behaviors is their connection with government. While we've talked about, and you know, media has talked a lot about how government holds back, you know, private sector. I think they also do really well when they partner, and they do really well in bringing companies to different countries and helping them with the market penetration strategies, right? Forging that relationship and that influencing power is huge. And also supporting from a financial perspective, you know, what do you need resources-wise? What do you need investment-wise? And if it's strategic enough and they see the bigger picture, I think that sometimes happens more readily.
And when you say that support, now first, what I understand is they are able to leverage the power of their government.
Yes.
Whereas most corporate leaders here want to work independent of the government.
Correct.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, in addition to that, though, our government often, if not almost always, tries to create a level playing field.
Yeah.
Meaning, if I go to our government and say, I need help competing against a Chinese bank, the answer is going to be, we're not going to help you because our goal is to make sure that everybody has the same access to the market, that we're not giving an artificial advantage to you as an American bank. But in China, there's a huge amount of cooperation between our competitors in China and the government in China. So they're working together. So that's, you know, that's in many respects helpful to those Chinese companies. It's, you know, something that many Americans find frustrating.
So going to the second point, being able to financially support a direction that may take significant investment over time.
Yes.
Would you call that alternatively as courage?
Sure. Yeah, that's courage.
So
we might call it risk taking in our vernacular, but sure, that's courage.
Okay. So you're saying they are more risk taking than American counterparts.
The word you're saying when I said supportive, are they more risk-taking?
Yeah.
I think they're very strategic, actually. I think they're strategic risk-takers. I don't think they're necessarily irresponsible about it.
What exactly do they have that is worth Americans to emulate? Because once you identify that, just like when you're in Japan, you identify they have this pursuit of perfection, this idea of kanzen, right? This idea of constantly improvement that American companies can apply to their own processes. What is that for the Chinese?
I'd say big picture view and solution orientation, right? Solution. What is the answer? What is the big picture answer in order to achieve success?
The 100-year marathon. To quote from the title of a book that came out last year, I'm not sure that I would necessarily agree with everything in the book, but the whole concept that the Chinese are more inclined to see the 100-year marathon, whereas we worry about quarter after quarter after quarter. And I think that's a huge advantage for a Chinese corporation.
Well, thank you again, Amy, for coming to speak with us. And that's another session of China 411. See you in the future.